Hi, welcome to part 7 of the Psychoacoustic series. Playlist link up there and in the description. This video is going to be corrections, clarifications, updates, and responses to your comments. So there aren't going to be any new psychoacoustic demonstrations here. In other words, this video is probably only for the diehards. But if you enjoyed those first 5 videos, you might want to check it out because I messed a couple things up and I'd like to set the record straight. First of all, the thing I most regret not mentioning in the first part of the series is that it's really important for your audio playback system to be presenting pure, unmolested audio to you. It turns out that in a lot of modern devices, there's all kinds of messing with the sound that happens, whether it's simulated surround sound or enhancements or EQ or volume boosters and all this stuff. Before you listen to the psychoacoustic demonstrations and the videos in this series, you really need to turn all of that stuff off. There's too many things to list in this video, so I'm just going to put it up on the screen now. Give it a pause and check it out to make sure none of those things are enabled on your system. It might take a little finagling in your control panel or whatever to find it, but make sure it's turned off. There are also some other considerations that might have messed with the demonstrations. For example, cable capacitance and crosstalk in headphones can be a problem even with high-end headphones and high-end interfaces. The other thing I really wish I had known about and mentioned is the terrible state of audio-visual synchronization when it comes to consumer devices. Meaning, in a video file where a certain event happens in time and there's a sound that happens at exactly the same time, the actual result you get when you play it back on your system can vary quite a lot. On my own system, between Windows and Linux, there was a 140 millisecond difference between the two operating systems, and they were both wrong, just in opposite directions. It's kind of a mess, and unfortunately, there's not really much that can be done about it unless you calibrate your own system. Anyway, if you're listening on headphones, let's do a quick check to make sure that the two channels are separated like they should be. Right now, this audio I'm playing in the left channel. You should be hearing this only in the left side. And what I'm going to ask you to do in a second is to take off the left headphone and cover it up with your hand or plug it up with your finger if it's an earbud or whatever you need to do so that you can't hear anything out of it. And while audio is playing out of that side, you'll listen to see if you can hear anything in the other side. You should hear silence, but if you can hear anything over there, that means there's some amount of crosstalk pollution going on in your headphones, okay? Okay, right now I'm in the center, but I'm going to fade over to the left. Take the left headphone off. Now, this audio should only be perceptible in the left side of your headphones. If you can hear anything on the right side, then that means you have some crosstalk happening. Okay, now we're back to center. Now take off your right headphone and we'll do the same test on the opposite side. This audio is only coming out of the right channel. You shouldn't hear anything in the left channel of your headphones. If you do, that means there's some amount of crosstalk happening. Okay, thanks for bearing with me on that. If you did hear some crosstalk going on, maybe you can get it sorted out and go back and listen to those demonstrations again and see if they work better for you. Otoacoustic emissions were talked about in part 1 of the video series, and I phrased things poorly and just generally confused some people about the relationship between otoacoustic emissions and tinnitus. It's not that otoacoustic emissions cause tinnitus or that tinnitus causes otoacoustic emissions. There is some overlap between those two symptoms, and that's really the only point I was trying to make. There are, in fact, many things that can cause tinnitus. As far as I understand it, the most common thing is exposure to loud sounds over time. But otoacoustic emissions are, as far as I know, not a common cause of tinnitus. Now let's talk about the pronunciation of tinnitus. In the medical world, itis, I-T-I-S, is a postfix that implies inflammation of some kind. Bronchitis, appendicitis, tendonitis, that kind of thing. Tinnitus is spelled I-T-U-S. It's not an itis, in other words. And in fact, inflammation is not generally associated with tinnitus. So tinnitus really is the more proper pronunciation. Tinnitus is accepted, but hopefully you can join with me on this crusade to keep the pronunciation as tinnitus. Speaking of otoacoustic emissions, I did finally manage to track down a recording of an otoacoustic emission. It's the only one I've been able to locate, so if you know of some others, please let me know. This recording was made by Andrew Bell and his colleagues. You can hear a heavy breathing sound, but in the background there's something that kind of sounds like a dial tone, and that's the otoacoustic emission. Again, this is the ear itself making noise. If you'd like to hear the entire recording, there's a link down in the description. There's also a link there to research that Andrew Bell has participated in. His list of papers is an impressive laundry list of fascinating subjects in the world of psychoacoustics, audio, and other fields. We talked about the tritone paradox in part 1. In that paradox, two tones are presented to the listener in series, and the listener is asked which of the two tones is higher. They're supposed to be a tritone apart, but due to a rendering mistake I made, they're actually a whole tone apart in my video. So I'm going to present the corrected audio to you now, listen to see which of these two tones sounds higher, and then go back to part 1 to find out more details about the paradox. In part two, we talked about the acoustic reflex. That's the set of muscles like the tensor tympani and the stapedius that regulate how much sound actually reaches our inner ear. A number of you wrote in to say that you can control your acoustic reflex willfully. I've heard this from a lot of commentators as well as people in my own life. I'm not exactly sure if what you're doing is intentional control of the acoustic reflex or if it's some other set of muscles in the head or the jaw or the inner ear, but at any rate, a lot of people seem to have that ability and it typically causes like a rumbling or whooshing sound when they do it, which makes sense because the contractions of muscles when you can hear them up close do make that sort of noise. At the end of part 5, I talked about what could be, but probably aren't, two novel effects in the world of psychoacoustics. One was the headphone pitch shift effect, which I mentioned in the last video is going to get its own dedicated video coming up. And the other was the consonance calibration effect. This is the effect where a deep bass line came in, along with a higher frequency melodic part on top. These two parts were actually a half step out of tune, and then after a moment for your ear to acclimate, they are changed to be in tune. I wanted to clarify what I was getting at with this effect. The fact that we can't tell that they're out of tune is not particularly surprising to me. We do have a harder time discriminating pitch down in bass frequencies, and when two parts are separated so far musically, it is difficult to tell if they're in tune or not. What is fascinating to me is the feeling that we get when that higher part shifts to be in tune with the lower part. It's that temporary moment where your brain is sort of calibrating and trying to understand why this thing that is in tune sounds out of tune. That kind of adjustment period is what I find interesting in that effect. In part one, we also talked about the missing fundamental effect. Unfortunately, I gave the impression with this effect that when the fundamental frequency is subtracted from a tone, that our ear fills that tone in. It's not exactly correct. The point is just that if you play, say, a guitar note like this, and then you take the fundamental frequency away, and then you ask someone to go to the piano and play the correlating note on the piano, they are most likely to play this note. They probably aren't going to play this note, even though technically that is where the fundamental frequencies align. The missing fundamental is just the point that your brain understands what the pitch is trying to be. You may not actually hear this missing fundamental as a ghostly tone that isn't actually present. Sometimes it can sound like the tone is actually present, but just not rich or deep in some way or another. It depends on the timbre of what you're listening to. Okay, let's talk about comments. I do read all the comments, and I try to follow up on all of them as well. If you wrote in about an effect that you've observed or something you thought I should check out and I didn't respond or I'm not mentioning it in this video, it doesn't mean I didn't pay attention to it. It just means I couldn't reproduce it. So if you really think there's something there, feel free to write in again, or better yet, try it on a friend of yours and see if you can reproduce it first, and then let me know about it. Okay, first of all, let's talk about binaural beats. This is definitely the thing that received the most comments in all the videos. My suspicion is that 75% of the people that couldn't hear the binaural beats couldn't hear it because of some issue in their playback system. You need really good channel separation and you need to be listening properly to be able to perceive the binaural beats. So go back to the beginning of this video and make sure your playback system is in order before you try those demonstrations again. One thing I want to make clear is that binaural beats are not what you use to tune your guitar. They're not what you use in orchestra class to tune your instruments. Those are just beats. Binaural beats is when each frequency is presented independently to each ear. That's why you have to use headphones or earbuds in order to hear binaural beats. If you're one of the people that commented about being able to hear them even though you were using speakers, you weren't hearing binaural beats. You were just hearing beats, because the sound waves combine in air and then you hear the beats. So if you want to hear binaural beats, make sure you're listening on headphones or earbuds. There's a link in the description for more information on binaural beats. And if you are in fact one of the people that could or couldn't hear the binaural beats when you were or weren't supposed to be able to hear them, don't worry. As far as I'm aware, it's a normal variation in human hearing, and it doesn't mean you're about to die. A number of folks wrote in to talk about yawning and its effect on their perception of pitch. There's a really great answer over at Music Stack Exchange about the way that the pressure of the fluid in the cochlea affects pitch perception. Based on that response, it seems convincing to me that a change in cochlear fluid pressure can explain why yawning might affect pitch perception. This also goes for being hungover or sleepy or just waking up and that kind of thing. Commentator Silent Sky wrote in with a really interesting effect. If they're listening to music that has a certain stereo soundstage on their headphones, and they're in, say, an elevator, if the elevator doors open and they walk out into a large reverberant acoustic space, they will actually perceive the stereo soundstage as widening when they walk into that space, even though they're listening strictly through earbuds. I think that's a really cool effect. I haven't experienced it myself, but if you have, please comment below. Landon Ramsey and Crystal Bell both wrote in saying that the hand that they were holding their device in would actually make a difference with some of the psychoacoustic demonstrations in this video series. I really love this kind of intermodal psychoacoustic effect, where something we see or feel or taste affects how we hear. In part two, we talked about chalkboard scraping. One of my favorite things to do in the comments was to read through everybody's description of what particular sound drives them crazy. Commentator Greg Conquest wrote, "When someone buzzes with their mouth into cellophane, it drives me crazy. A spasm runs up my spine and I feel almost sick." Barnaby Wilde said, "Styrofoam packing material rubbed against the cardboard box it came in will run me out of a room. That sound weakens and tortures me to the point of having a flight response." I know what you guys mean. A butter knife on a porcelain plate for me? Just terrible. A lot of people had trouble with styrofoam and cardboard for some reason. I mentioned my hypothesis that it might have something to do with teeth and nails, and commentator Steve Clark agrees. He says, "When my teeth feel vulnerable, the sensation heightens for me to an unbearable degree." Whatever the cause is, I hope scientists look into this a little bit more. It seems like the prevailing explanations are really unsatisfactory. It's got to be the most intense psychoacoustic effect I know of, and it seems like we really just have no idea what's going on with it. Okay, I mentioned already that the headphone pitch shift video is going to come out soon. I'm also releasing an album of mostly instrumental tunes, and I'm going to be releasing all of those on my second channel. On the first channel, I'm going to release versions where I talk about the music theory and the structure behind the tunes. Patreon link in the description. Thanks. Talk to you soon.